حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يقول الله تعالى بعد نعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، ونعوذ بالله تعالى من النار. Ameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the end of Surah Ghafir to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلًا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَصَصْنَا عَلَيْكَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ لَمْ نَقْصُصْ عَلَيْكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have sent messengers before you. Of course, he was not the first one. Some of them we have narrated their stories to you, and others we did not. So we know many messengers came and many prophets came before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they came many times with different sharias or different legislations because their circumstances required different rulings. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِكُلِّ مِنْكُمْ جَعَلْنَا شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. We have given you different legislations and ways of life. However, there were commonalities in their messages. For example, every messenger came with the message of La ilaha illallah, that there's no God worthy of worship except from Allah. Except for Allah. And this is something every messenger and every prophet came to their people with. Another message that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his hadith narrated by Abi Musa, tells us that there is another message that was common amongst every prophet. And in this hadith in which Abi Musa says that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ مِمَّا أَدْرَكَ النَّاسِ مِنْ كَلَامِ النُّبُوَّةِ الْأُولَى إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَاصْنَعْ مَا شِئْتْ. Some of the, or one of the remnants that has reached the people from the message of the previous prophets, meaning there is something that remains in the messages of the previous prophets, which is this: if you have no shame, then do as you wish. If you have no haya or modesty or shame, then do as you wish. And my dear respected brothers and sisters and respected elders, if we contemplate over the moral degradation or the declination that we see around us in society today, the moral decline, we see that in reality, yes, when people have no haya and they have no faith and no modesty, that there are no borders that they are not willing to cross. It used to be some years ago that the biggest fear for a Muslim parent would be that their child would come home and tell them that they have a boyfriend or a girlfriend at school. Of course, a boy telling him that he has a girlfriend, or a girl telling him that she has a boyfriend. This was the biggest fear. And then when the smartphones came around, the biggest fear for parents is, what is my child watching? What is my child consuming on their phones when they go up to bed at night? And we know that statistically speaking, almost unfortunately, 98% of men in Western societies, or all societies unfortunately, are exposed to these illicit videos, these adult videos, on a regular basis. And children as young as the age of 8 are exposed to these
filthy movies. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protection for us and them. And then things continued to get worse until it became promoted and encouraged for children to come out as being homosexual. And then it continued to decline until we now see a boy no longer has to be a boy if he chooses, and a girl no longer has to be a girl if she chooses. And as Muslims living in this country, we have the religious freedom and the freedom of speech to talk about these things. Of course, without intolerance, without hate speech, and without dealing other with others with inequity. No, we are still just, and we still deal with others with equity and fairness and justice as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, even if we don't agree with them. But we are allowed to discuss these things, and we should discuss these things amongst ourselves and our communities and with our families, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Save yourselves, O believers, and your families from the hellfire. And it's important to know about these vices and these evils in society. But the one sin that I want to discuss, inshallah, today with the short amount of time that I have with you, is a sin that is very prevalent in the summertime. When dresses get shorter and tops get higher, unfortunately, and that is the sin of not lowering the gaze. And the problem, especially today with the media and technology that is available, when somebody is not able to lower their gaze on the streets, in their stores, in their businesses, in their colleges, in their classrooms, what happens is the sin continues to pile up more and more upon a person until they finally do something haram by watching something impermissible on their videos or on their phones, or committing straight out zina. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protection. And this problem with not lowering the gaze, wallahi, it's not just something that Muslims agree is harmful. And this is why movies have, for example, PG-13, rated R, because they know that not everybody can be exposed to certain content. They realize that it could be damaging even for young kids before a certain age. And as a matter of fact, the state of Arizona has declared pornography to be, unfortunately, a national health crisis. I mean, you're talking about 300% spike in cases of infidelity, meaning men cheating on their spouses due to this sin directly. And actually, there was a statistic that said about 60% of divorces are caused by this. And a good friend of mine, Brother Raymond Brock, he's actually a psychiatrist in Manhattan. He has told me that even Muslim women have come to their his office with their husbands complaining that their husband is not able to lower their gaze, and it is destroying their relationship, and she's asking for divorce. I mean, you can imagine how embarrassing such a situation would be for the sister, that she has to go actually take him to a psychiatrist and try to find help for that problem. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his protection. It's important to remember that the eyes, my dear respected brothers and sisters, our eyes commit zina. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, zina al-ayn al-nadhar, that the zina that the eye commits is when it looks at something haram and impermissible. And you could be looking at something haram, whether it's a video or something that you see on the streets or in your office, and enjoying it, and you're actually participating in the sin, even though you're not doing the sin. Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, إِذَا عُمِلَتِ الْخَطِيئَةِ فِي الْأَرْضِ, when a sin takes place anywhere in the earth or anywhere in the lands, كَانَ مَنْ شَهِدَهَا فَأَنْكَرَهَا كَمَنْ غَابَ عَنْهَا وَمَنْ غَابَ عَنْهَا وَرَضِيَهَا أَوْ فَرَضِيَهَا كَمَنْ شَهِدَهَا. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when a sin takes place, the people who are present around that sin, seeing it, but they are against it and they hate it, then they are guilt-free. It's as if they're not even there. But somebody who is not even there, who's halfway across the earth, sitting in his bedroom, watching something on his TV or on his phone, but he is actually pleased and enjoying that sin, it is as if that person is actually there participating in it. And unfortunately, the more you expose yourself to these images, as Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi said, that the heart is like your house and your eyes are the window. Imagine if you opened all the windows in your house at all times. What happens? Somebody that you won't want in your house will eventually find his way in. A burglar, a robber, a murderer. Likewise, if your eyes are open at all times for everything, then you're letting shaitan freely enter and leave as he pleases into your heart, which is your house. And the more you expose yourself to looking at that which is haram, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in the hadith narrated by Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, تُعْرَضُ الْفِتَنَ عَلَى الْقُلُوبِ, that the fitna or the tests or the sins will be exposed to the hearts, meaning they will be exposed to these fitna. So any heart that أَيُّ قَلْبٍ أُشْرِبُهَا, any heart that is actually infatuated and enjoys this particular sin, نُكْتَتْ فِيهِ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدَاءٌ. A dark spot will begin to take hold on that heart. And then the dark spots will continue to accumulate. حَتَّى يَسِيرْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَسْوَدَ مُرَبَّدَ كَالْكُوزِ مُجَخِّيَ. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says this heart will eventually become so dark and so gloomy that it will be like an upside down cup. If you have an upside down cup, I don't care what you try to pour in it, nothing is gonna reach the inside of the cup. Likewise, this heart will become so closed that no good, the message of the Quran, a warning, a reminder, or a hadith, nothing will be able to enter this heart because it has been completely sealed due to these dark spots. إِلَّا مَا أُشْرِبَ مِنْ هَوَىٰ. As the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said, the only thing that he will be benefited by is something that is already in line with his desires. That is it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protection from that and to keep our hearts clean. My dear respected brothers, sin is the means to kufr. Yes, al-ma'siyah baridul kufr, as the scholars have said, it is a means that leads to kufr. Why? Because every time you sin, your iman drops. And the more you repeat a sin over and over without tawbah, sincere tawbah, your iman, your faith drops more and more and more. And then eventually there's no more iman left. And a person finds himself so spiritually and emotionally fatigued that shaitan can just do whatever they want with this person. They can offer no resistance whatsoever to shaitan because they have depleted their iman through these sins. So any whispers or any doubts shaitan wants to put in this person's heart, this person is ready and willing to accept it. It's important also to remember that sins, they pretty much permeate into every aspect of your life. And they can destroy every aspect of your life, not just your religiosity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءٌ يُجْزَ بِهِ. Any sin that you do, you will be recompensed for that sin in the dunya or in the akhirah. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدِ لَيُحْرَمَ الرِّزْقِ بِالذَّنْبِ أَذْنَبُهُ. A person can be prevented from risk, from provision, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of a sin that person engaged in. So it affects every aspect of your life. And the last thing I want to mention to you, inshallah, to bear in mind about the negative consequences of not lowering your gaze, even though there are so many more that we can discuss, but we want to make room for the other aspects of this talk or the other points, inshallah, which is that you're really only hurting yourself. You're not going to get any long-term benefit or enjoyment out of not lowering your gaze. As a matter of fact, the more you expose yourself to things that are haram and looking at images that are haram, the more depressed and anxious you will make yourself. Why? Because you're always exposing yourself to looking at things that you want, but you cannot have. As the poet said, وَكُنْتَ مَتَى أَرْسَلْتَ طَرْفَكَ رَائِدًا لِقَلْبِكَ يَوْمًا أَتْعَبَتْكَ الْمَنَاظِرُ رَأَيْتَ الَّذِي لَا كُلَّهُ أَنْتَ قَادِرٌ عَلَيْهِ وَلَا عَنْ بَعْضِهِ أَنْتَ صَابِرُ. He said, as soon as you let your eyes just roam free, you will exhaust yourself. Why? Because you will see all the things that you desire, but you have no patience on the fact that you cannot have them all. So in reality, by exposing yourself constantly to these images and these videos, and I don't want to get too detailed and explicit in the language because of the youth, inshallah, that are here, but you understand what I'm saying. The more depressed a person can become because they're looking at what they want, but they cannot have. So what is the point of all of these? What is the point of enjoying yourself for a few minutes or a few seconds if it comes with all of these negative consequences? As the poet said, لا مرحبا بسرور عاد بالضرر. There is no welcome to a happiness, the end result of which is misery or harm. And shaitan is the one who, subhanAllah, very trickily comes to you and promises you that when you commit this sin, when you watch this video, when you look at that person in the street, or you look at that woman in the office, or that man for the sister, that you will be happy. He will convince you, and you'll be so convinced that by doing it, yes, I will feel some sort of satisfaction and happiness. And then when a person goes through with it, they realize that, wow, it only led me to misery and regret and depression. Why did I let myself be tricked over and over and over again? This is because shaitan does not come to you and tell you sin. Rather, he comes to you and promises you the positive results that he convinces you can have out of that sin. For example, he did not come to our father Adam and say, go eat from the tree. He said, هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَىٰ شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَىٰ. Should I not lead you, O Adam, to the tree of eternal life and a kingdom which will never deteriorate. This is what he promised him. And when Adam listened to him, alayhi salam, he got the opposite. He lost eternal life in paradise and he lost his kingdom temporarily, of course. So when shaitan promises you happiness will come as a result of disobeying Allah, realize, my dear respected brothers, that the opposite is actually true. You will only get misery and you will lose the happiness of obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, if anyone wants to think or be convinced of the fact that life would not be satisfactory or they will not be able to enjoy life unless they look at these haram videos or images or expose themselves to it, ask yourself, how are people enjoying life before the iPhone, before TVs, before computers? So what is the prevention, inshallah, we will go over very quickly. Firstly, we look no further than the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has given us the cure for every disease of the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nur, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. Tell the believing men to lower their gaze and protect their private parts or protect their chastity. So he linked the gaze with the protection of the chastity, and the same thing for the sisters. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنْ. So that is the first thing. As the poet said, كُلُّ الْحَوَادِثْ مَبْدَأُهَا مِنَ النَّظَرِ وَمُعْضُمِ النَّارِ مِنْ مُسْتَصْغَرِ الشَّرِّ. Most calamities and most sins begin with that first look. And most big blazes, these big fires that you see, they started with a small spark. So that is important to keep in mind. When you leave your house in the morning on a fresh, with a fresh slate, with a clean slate, when you're going to work, driving in your car, walking to the bus, taking the subway, know that you are on your guard. Know that you are on guard protecting your heart from the second you walk out of your house. And this is the attitude you have to have. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who does he praise? وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ. The ones who are always actively guarding their chastity. Think of somebody who is an active guard. For example, the president has secret service around him. The secret service does not wait till somebody is standing right in front of the president holding a gun to his head. No, they neutralize any threat way before it gets that far. So as a protector of your chastity, when you walk out in the morning, you need to have this attitude. What is a potential threat when you're walking to the bus or driving your car? You see somebody from your peripherals, from the side of your eyes. You could tell that somebody's not dressed properly. Why would you look in that direction? You haven't been exposed to the image yet. It should be easy at this point to not look in that direction, because the second you expose yourself to it, guess what? That is the first arrow of Iblis. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, "An-nadhara sahmun masmumun min sihami Iblis." That the look a person takes at the opposite gender is one of the poisoned arrows of Satan. Once that poisoned arrow hits you, it's not meant to kill you, but it's definitely gonna weaken you. So now the next time you're exposed to looking at something haram, it'll be harder to avoid than the first. And then the third time will be harder to avoid than the second, until eventually the person is just basically so wounded that shaitan can just come in for the kill and cause him to do any sin that he wants him to do to satisfy that desire that is already there. But remember, no matter how many looks a person takes, Allah's door of tawbah is always open. Never say to yourself, it's too late, shaitan has already got me. Inna kayda shaitani kana da'ifa. The plotting of shaitan is indeed weak, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our protector. So now I want to give you another point from our sharia. And it's something that seems to be controversial now, which is, I'll give you an example. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you can draw your own conclusions from this. In the masjid, out of all places, in the masjid, he would say, خَيْرُ صُفُوفِ الرِّجَالَ أَوَّلُهَا وَشَرُّهَا آخِرُهَا وَشَرُّ صُفُوفِ النِّسَاءَ أَوَّلُهَا وَخَيْرُهَا آخِرُهَا كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. That the best lines to pray in the masjid for the men is the front, and the worst is the back. And the best line for the woman to pray in her salah is the back, and the worst is the front. Meaning the lines that are closest together between the two genders are the least favorable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now bear in mind, this is in the masjid, behind the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and these are the sahaba, and guess what? They're not even facing each other. They're all facing the qibla. So the men and the women are not even facing each other, but with that, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the worst of the lines are those that are closest to one another. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also in the hadith of Ibn Umar, he saw a door by the entrance of the masjid. He said, لو تركنا هذا الباب للنساء, we should leave this door for the women to enter alone. So that way they are not mixing with the men on the way out. And I'll add to that, the fact that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith narrated by Salama, he would, when he made taslim from his salah, when he would say, assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, he would not get up and walk out right away. He used to sit and wait until the woman in the back have left the masjid, then him and his companions would get up and leave the masjid to ensure that there is no basically unnecessary mixing. Where? He's not talking about the mall. He's not talking about a college campus. He's talking about the masjid, the most beloved places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the companions, the greatest generation to walk the face of the earth, the greatest generation of Muslims. And this is the length to which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to ensure that there is no unnecessary mixing taking place in the masjid. So if this was his attitude with the masjid, my question to you very simply is, how would the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam respond to some of our mixed occasions, specifically weddings, specifically engagement parties, so on and so forth, birthday parties, where there's a mixing of genders, where there is music, many times dancing, many times men and women sitting down, frolicking, enjoying themselves with no care whatsoever about lowering their gaze? How would he respond to that if this was his attitude about the masajid, the most purest of places? And you can draw your own conclusions from that. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the sahaba, the most purest of hearts, وَإِذَا سَأَلْتُمُوهُنَّ مَتَاعًا فَاسْأَلُوهُنَّ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ ذَلِكُمْ أَطْهَرُ لِقُلُوبِكُمْ وَقُلُوبِهِنَّ. If you ask the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for something, ask her behind a curtain. And then he said, that is purer for your heart and their heart. So if it's purer for the hearts of the sahaba, who have the purest hearts already, to ask the Prophet's wife, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is their mother, وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُ, his wives are the Prophet's mothers, to ask them only behind a curtain so there is no visual contact, and that is purer for their hearts, what does that tell you about our hearts' needs for minimizing unnecessary contact? And again, I use the word unnecessary. Of course, there are necessities. For example, a man works in an office where there are women, or a woman attending school, so on and so forth, where it's out of their choice. I'm talking about unnecessary mixing. When you have a bunch of brothers, for example, in the family sitting down on the same couch, all of them sitting with their wives, and it's perfectly normal. And you, if you say something about this, they will say, that's his sister-in-law, that's his brother-in-law, that's his cousin. For example, a cousin is not a mahram, my dear respected brothers. A person is in Islam allowed to marry their cousin. So these are not good excuses. As a matter of fact, the closer the two are to one another, the more dangerous it could be. Which is why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his companions, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالدُّخُولَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, be careful to not enter upon women in their homes. And an Ansari, he asked him, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَرَأَيْتَ الْحَمُوُ, how about the brother-in-law? Is he have special permission? He said, rather, al-hamu al-mot. No, the brother-in-law is death, meaning he is a worst-case scenario to be entering upon a woman. Why? Because there is already that relationship, that level of comfort, that makes it easier for shaitan to slip in. Whereas when it's two total strangers, there's already this ice that's not yet broken. But when you have two people who already know one another and are familiar with one another, shaitan can use that more to his advantage. So do not be deceived. And another thing I will say to you, do not trust yourself so much. إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي. The soul calls to evil, except whom those Allah has mercy on. We ask Allah to be amongst them. So when you're sitting at home, don't trust yourself so much that you can flip through your social media. Whether or not, I mean, tell me, if you're following people who are only religious figures, that's one thing. But if you're following Al-Barr wal-Fajr, whether a person is righteous or not, and you know they post images on their social media that are going to be harmful to your heart, then why are you exposing yourself to this? Why are you flipping through channels not knowing what you're going to see on the next channel? No, your heart is your prized possession. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day, no money or children will benefit anyone except the one who comes to Allah with a pure heart. So we need to bear in mind, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ, the ones who are always actively guarding their chastity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst them. And the harder you try, the easier Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it for you. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the ones who strive in our path, we will make our way easy for them. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَنْ يَسْتَعِفْ يُعِفُّهُ اللَّهُ, whoever seeks to be chaste, Allah will make chastity easy for that person. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us. Allahumma nas'aluka al-huda wal-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina. Aqulu kama sami'tum wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiru.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
Wallahi, the rewards for lowering your gaze are countless. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi said, you will not find anyone who lives a happier and more pleasing life than the one who lowers his gaze for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything that you leave for Allah, illa baddalaka Allahu ma huwa khayrun laka minhu, aw kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything you leave for Allah, Allah will replace for you with something better in your dunya and in your akhirah. In one narration, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man ghadda basarahu an maharim Allah, عَوَضَهُ اللَّهُ إِيمَانًا يَجِدُ حَلَاوَتَهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ. Anyone who lowers their gaze from that which is haram, Allah will place in his heart an iman that he will taste the sweetness of. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expand your risk and your happiness, and he will put barakah in your relationship with your spouse. And that's the other thing I want to mention, inshallah, and I'll try to leave off with that. We need to make marriage easier on our shabab, my dear respected elders. Wallahi, the doors of haram are many. They're very easy and they're very accessible and they're wide open in this society. So if we close and we restrict the doors of halal and we make it difficult for our young brothers and sisters to get married, unfortunately, we have to keep in mind that the doors of haram are easier and more accessible. So we have to make it easier. And inshallah, I will say to you that no matter how far you have been involved in this sin or how long you have been involved in it, Allah is the one who cures all diseases. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. If I am sick, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who cures me, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us to say. Know that Yusuf alayhi salam did not seek his own willpower. Rather, he said, مَعَاذَ Allah, I seek the protection of Allah. He did not refer to himself, or he did not rely on himself. Rather, he relied on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected him from that fitna. So do not rely on yourself. Do not put yourself in places and situations where you are going to be exposed to this sin if you have not overcome it. Do not sit in your house by yourself unnecessarily. Come to the masjid. Keep yourself occupied. Do not go to sleep with the phone in your hand if you're not already exhausted. You should only be going to bed when you are exhausted. You need to cut the means of this sin for yourself and for your children as well. And to remember, inshallah, and wallahi, I will end with this, bi-idhnillah, I don't want to go over my time. No matter how many times a person commits any sin, whether it's this sin or any other sin, no matter how bad it gets and how often he repeats it, as long as they continue to come back to Allah with the intent to repent and not go back to it, even if it's just the intent, because a person can have the intent to not return to the sin and then return to it an hour later. But if they have the intention and they return to Allah repentantly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will continue to forgive as long as you continue to ask. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith Qudsi, Ya Ibn Adam, إِنَّكَ مَا دَعَوْتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. O son of Adam, as long as you continue to have hope in me and ask my forgiveness, I will continue to forgive whatever you have, and I do not even care. Because our sins, they don't hurt Allah, they only hurt us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always ready and willing to forgive. The last thing I will say, please, inshallah, if a person has a problem with not able to lower their gaze, whether it's from these videos or anything else, then there is no shame in seeking professional help. There are many psychiatrists. There's actually an organization called Purify Your Gaze, and they help people get over this problem. You can find them online, and they actually said they're willing to help people who have financial difficulties and not have to pay anything for their services or to visit a psychiatrist. But we have to exhaust all means to ensure that we're doing everything we can to keep our hearts safeguarded, because as I mentioned, that is the only thing that will benefit us on that day. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts. Allahumma tahhir qulubana wa hassir furujana wa ghfir dhunubana. Allahumma a'inna ala dhikrik wa shukrik wa husni ibaratik. Allahumma aati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha anta waliyuha wa mawlaha. Allahumma ghfir lil muslimin wal muslimat, al mu'minin wal mu'minat, al ahya minhum wal amwat. We were asked actually by brother Omar Malik's father, Mudaffar Malik. He passed away in Pakistan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him. Allahumma ighfir lahu warhamhu wa'afihi wa'afu anhu wa akrim nuzlahu wa wassi' mudkhalahu wa ghsilhu bil thalji wal ma'i wal barad وباعد بينه وبين خطاياه كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب. اللهم أدخل، اللهم وسع مدخله، اللهم ابدله دارا خيرا من داره وأهلا خيرا من أهله، وأدخله الجنة. اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وذكرنا وأنثانا. اللهم من أحييته منه منا فأحيه على الإسلام، ومن توفيته منا فتوفيه على الإيمان. اللهم لا تحرمنا أجره ولا تفتنا بعده، واغفر لنا وله ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات. أقول كما سمعتم واستغفر الله لي ولكم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
سووا صفوفكم من تسويد الصفوف من تمام الصلاة. Straighten your lines. It is part of completion of prayer. You can stand shoulder to shoulder, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum.
Allahu Akbar.
Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Tabarakallah.